Hey guys, Zookeeper Liz here, and today I'm hanging out with my favourite echidna, Leo. And he might look a little bit different from a standard echidna, and that's because he's actually an albino. Bye, Leo. He's leaving me. So Leo is an albino animal, and the chances of an animal being an albino is about 1 in 17,000. So he's very rare, but for an echidna, not as rare as it is for a wallaby to be an albino. They're not highly predated on out in the wild. The spines all over his body do keep him very, very safe from anything trying to eat him. They might have a couple of goes at trying to eat them, but an echidna is not really an ideal meal, that's for sure. Now, what Leo was eating a little while ago, and I'll see if he wants anything else to eat. Do you want something else to eat? What Leo was eating and is now eating is what we like to refer to as an echidna smoothie. So an echidna smoothie doesn't have echidna in it. It has lots of different things. So out in the wild, their natural diet is actually insects. So they'd be eating ants and termites, lots of different things like that. So what we do is we make up a special diet. So it contains an insectivore powder, a vitamin E, calcium, lots of other different things, a lean mincemeat, and we blend it up into what looks like a little bit of peanut butter or porridge. But I do not suggest eating it at home. Do not try this for yourself. It is definitely a specialized diet for an echidna. As you can tell, he really, really does love it. We also do give them things such as rotten logs and parts of termite mound so they can have that natural diet as well. But this does do them really great here in at Symbio. Leo has a very, very long tongue. It's about 20 centimeters in length, and this enables him to be able to get into all the nooks and crannies in amongst rotten logs. He'll actually use his front feet that are quite strong to break through termite mounds and be able to eat up all of those yummy ants and termites. At the back of his snout, he does actually have two plates that he uses to crush all of the ants that he's bringing into his mouth. So he doesn't really have teeth. Those two plates do all of the grinding effort for him, and he doesn't really have to worry about a live ant going down into his tummy. Echidnas are a very special animal known as a monotreme. Now, there's only three different monotremes in the entire world, and two of which are found here right in Australia. So one of them is a short-beaked echidna, Leo here, and then the other species found in Australia is a platypus. And then there is one other found in Papua New Guinea, and they are called a long-beaked echidna. So they are about double the size of a short-beaked echidna, have a longer beak, a longer snout, and they don't have so many spines all over them. They are mainly covered in hair. But unfortunately for the long-beaked echidna, there's not too many of them left out in the wild because they are eaten as a delicacy. So they're hunted, and it's not very good for them. And I can't imagine they would be too tasty either. It's very hard to tell the difference between a male and female echidna. Just by looking at them on the outside, you can't tell, so you have to get a vet to tell you which is which. But when you do see them out in the wild, you may only see one male and one female together in the breeding season, but you might also see one female with up to 10 to 11 males following her around in a train. So it'd be like a conga line of echidnas. So they will be following her around, trying to win her heart, and when she finally decides who she's going to breed with, they will breed and then they will part ways after that. After about 3 weeks, mum is then going to lay an egg directly into her pouch. Now, it's not like a chicken's egg. It's very leathery on the outside, so it's a little bit softer, not so easy to break. That little egg will stay in mum's pouch for about 10 days, and then after that 10-day period, out will hatch a puggle. It might sound like a bit of a strange word, puggle, and the only way really to describe what a puggle looks like is for anyone that may have seen SpongeBob, Patrick the Starfish. They look like that, but they're only about this big, very teeny tiny. And that will stay inside mum's pouch for about 8 to 10 weeks. Now, inside that pouch, there isn't any teats for the baby to be able to drink mum's milk, but it will secrete straight through her skin. So all that little puggle has to do is attach directly to mum's skin in her pouch and just start to suckle on mum's milk. When they're born, they're not so spiky, so it's very comfortable for mum and for puggle inside that pouch. But as they start to grow and develop those spines, it can become a little bit uncomfortable. So at about that 10-week mark, Mum's going to find somewhere that is really, really safe for her little puggle to spend all of its time while she goes off and finds lots and lots of yummy ants so that she can supply that milk for her baby. So she will build a nursery for it. We'll actually build up a wall so that that echidna cannot leave. That puggle's safe staying there all by itself. She'll leave for up to a week and return once a week to feed that puggle. And after a few months, once they're completely covered in spines like Leo is, they'll then be able to head off on their own. Mum might come back one final time to let them out, but most of the time they have to dig themselves out and work it out on their own. A bit of a shock into the real world, but they have all of the spines to keep them very, very safe from those predators. We're wondering where more food is, aren't we, Leo? So these spines are made out of the same protein that our hair and fingernails are made out of, so keratin. So they aren't born with them, they do grow them over time. And depending upon where you do find the echidna, it will vary in appearance. So it may not have as many spines or as much hair, depending upon where around Australia you do find them. So the further south that you do travel, they can lighten in colour. So generally an echidna will not be white in colour, but they are tend to be that blacky browny in colour. So they can get a little bit lighter, more blonde on the ends of the tips of their hair. They have a lot more hair when it's cooler and not so many spines in between. Where are you going, Leo? So echidnas are covered in spines all over their body, and they are made out of the same protein that our hair and fingernails are made out of, keratin. And they can grow and shed them much like we grow and shed our own hair. Depending upon where you find the echidna throughout Australia, it will vary in appearance and also in size. So the further south or the cooler that the area does get, the echidnas can actually get a little bit bigger, but they tend to have a little bit more hair in between those spines and maybe not so many spines on their body. Whereas if you get into a warmer climate, they tend to have less hair and more spines. So they don't need that temperature regulation from the hair in between the spines. They just need their spines to protect them from being eaten. So if Leo was out in the wild, being an albino, he's gonna stand out a little bit more than our other darker coloration of echidna, but he's very, very safe. If he is feeling threatened, what he's going to do is tuck his nose under his chest. He's gonna curl up into a really tight ball, and nothing's really going to be able to tip him over. They are incredibly strong animals, so he can hold on to the ground. No one's really gonna be able to flip him over because underneath there's just that hair, there's no spines under there. So if he comes into trouble, if a cat's chasing him down, he's just going to either dig himself down underground, curl up into a ball, and they tend to just, the cat will just leave him alone, head off in the other direction. If you are lucky enough to have an echidna in your backyard and you do have a cat or you do have a dog, try and keep them in sight because you don't want to scare them away from your backyard. It's a bit of a privilege being able to have such an incredible native animal visit you in your own backyard. So keep them inside, and their chances are that echidna is just going to be moving through. You might have a little bit of an ant problem, so they might help you out with that one, but they're probably not going to hang around for too long. And then once they're gone, you can let those animals back out into your backyard without the worry of upsetting any of our native animals. Now, if Leo was out in the wild and there was a bushfire that was tearing through his habitat, he likes to dig down underground. So if he's really, really worried about a bushfire, he's gonna dig down as far as he can, and that fire will actually pass over the top of him and he's not going to be injured at all. If there is anything that is threatening echidnas out in the wild, it's actually our motor vehicles, so our cars and our trucks. Unfortunately, echidnas don't know to look left and right when crossing the road, so we have to do that for them. If you do ever see an echidna out in the wild and they are on the road, what I do encourage you to do is try and maneuver your car around them, if at all possible and safe to do so as well. They don't tend to be fast moving on the road like a kangaroo is. Kangaroos jump all over the place, but echidnas are just waddling across the road. There might be better ants on the other side. If it's safe for you to pull over and hopefully relocate that echidna, I suggest having something very thick in the back of your car, a really thick towel, or maybe even some welding gloves in the back of your car as well to be able to pick them up. chances are, and a wild kidna has never been picked up before, so they're probably going to curl up into that ball and try and hold onto the road, even though you're trying to do them a favor by moving them off of the road. If you cannot lift them up off the road, or if you are concerned that they may have been struck down by a car, your best effort that what you can do is actually calling a rescue service such as Wires. Leo does have a very special story. When he was a puggle about 10 years ago, he was actually handed in to Symbio here, and our director did actually hand raise him. So this is why he does really enjoy having encounters with people as well. As long as there is food involved, Leo is more than happy to hang out with us. His tongue is really going there. He's looking for more food. Always very, very hungry boy. Now you can actually see his front feet at the moment, and he's got really thick claws. And what he uses these claws for is digging himself down underground. So an echidna can move nearly 200 cubic meters of soil a year, and that is a lot for an animal that only weighs about 4 or 5 kilos. So they are an ecosystem engineer. They're very crucial for the environments and the ecosystems that we find them in across Australia. So if you are ever lucky enough to come across one, have a look, maybe take a photo from a safe distance, but try not to interrupt them too much. They're doing a very important job of keeping those forest areas very well nourished by the leaf litter on the ground that they are turning over and mixing through that soil. So underneath, Leo has soft hair, so it's not so spiky under there, but you can see on his back foot he does actually have curved claws, and this enables him to be able to groom himself. So if he has anything such as a tick in on his body, he can use these claws to actually remove them off of himself. And he's got very strong front feet as well. He uses these to dig lots and lots of holes, dig himself deep underground as well. In winter time, echidnas will actually go into a form of hibernation known as torpor. And he'll use his claws to dig himself a very impressive burrow, and he'll stay underground for a few months, and once he emerges back out, that will be when it is breeding season, so springtime typically when he's coming out of torpor.